The computing power of today is based on increasingly teeny tiny bits of silicon, which conducts electricity, transistors. What happens when we can't make them any smaller and then can't make the CPUs in our computers any faster? In this episode of Future of Tech, I'll dive into how DNA computing works, why it is on the mind of researchers, and why Microsoft and IBM are investing large sums of cash in making the technology a reality. Welcome to Biological Computing. It's no surprise that the amount of data we are producing in the world is exploding. Where do we store it though? And how do we process it? Quantum computing is one way, and of course, this show has an episode on that. But there are many hard problems to solve with quantum. For one, quantum computing requires an extremely cold operating environment. So cold that atoms are at an almost complete stop. Below 1 Kelvin, actually, which is minus 272 degrees Celsius. And that requires immense amounts of energy and space-age tech to make happen. In order to show that funny laughing llama video you were watching before, transistors in computers are passing electrical signals. A lot of signals. The transistors in the latest CPUs are getting incredibly tiny, just a few nanometers. If the transistors get any smaller though than they are currently, the electrical current flowing through the transistor easily leaks out into other components nearby or deforms the transistor due to heat. And then you get messy currents, which doesn't calculate anything. Innovation in computing could come to a halt. What we need is another way to keep improving the performance of computing. And one very promising approach is to use the biocompatible computing device,
deoxyribonucleic acid.
DNA computing. Yeah, DNA. No, it's not about finding fossilized mosquitoes in pieces of amber, like that one. DNA computing uses DNA, biochemistry and molecular biology hardware. In fact, you already own a DNA computing device. You! Yeah. In DNA, genetic coding is represented by four different molecules called A, T, C, and G. These four bits, when chained together, can hold an incredible amount of data. After all, the human genome is encoded in something that can be packed into a single nucleus of a cell, which is about that big. It's small. DNA computing isn't a new concept as such. In 1964, Russian physicist Mikhail Samuilovich Neyman expressed original ideas and principal considerations of radical miniaturization on elements for recording, storing, and retrieving of digital information to the molecular atomic level. In other words, DNA computing. It wasn't until the 1990s that actual work started with storing data on strands of DNA when Leonard Adelman presented the first prototype of a DNA computer. It was called the TT-100 and was basically a test tube. TT was in fact short for test tube, seriously. And you might be thinking by now, but Laz, what does a DNA computer look like? Well, good question. The TT-100 might have given a clue to this. The actual computing takes place when DNA is mixed and matched in a test tube. Will you need test tubes in your laptop then? I'll get to that shortly. The data we produce every second of every hour of every day has to go somewhere. But where? Currently, a lot of it ends up in the cloud. Cloud-hosted storage is super cheap, and it is estimated by 2025, half of the 175 zettabytes of data produced will be stored in the cloud. Yeah, you heard that word too, right? Zettabyte. A billion terabytes. Microsoft is also concerned about having to store all of these catgibs and meme generators, so they're investing in DNA computing technology. In 2019, researchers from Microsoft and the University of Washington demonstrated the first fully automated system to store and retrieve data in manufactured DNA. They wrote, "Hello, not as impressive as the literary works of Shakespeare or the best pizza recipes in the world, but it was done with snippets of fabricated DNA. The end goal is to reduce warehouse-sized data centers into something much smaller. Now, the cool thing is that the end consumer will never know. Storage will just continue to be storage. And speaking of storage, the researchers at Washington University have so far managed to store 1 gigabyte in DNA. And yes, they did store funny cat photos. So here are 4 reasons why a future that uses DNA computing makes sense. It's cheap. We have DNA all around us. It is in every cell of every organic living thing. There is plenty of stock available. Producing it cheaply, though, is the main hurdle currently, as we don't use actual human DNA. Rather, it is produced artificially, which will be cheap, once the scales of economy work in our favor. Number 2, easy to produce. We do it all the time. DNA wants to reproduce, just like the show. We can't stop it now, even if we wanted to. Number 3, scalable. Scientists estimate that DNA could hold 455 exabytes of data in all. An exabyte equals a quintillion bytes, or 1 billion gigabytes. Formatted in DNA, every movie ever made would fit inside a volume smaller than a sugar cube. Just don't put it in your coffee. Number 4, parallel computing. DNA can perform countless calculations in parallel. Where classical computing quickly reaches a limit of how many parallel computations can be made, DNA computing has almost no limit. This makes it ultra fast and incredibly powerful for scenarios like machine learning. So when can you buy your own DNA computer and fill it with all of the internet? Probably not anytime soon, if ever. The future of computing is not about extremely powerful devices in your pocket, but rather super fast connections to the cloud and other services. DNA computers will be doing huge calculations and store enormous amounts of data, but in a fixed location. Cost has to come down first, though. The current cost of storing and encoding 1 megabyte of data is $1 million. Yeah. One area that will benefit hugely is data security. DNA-based security. Sounds like a terrible plot in a cheap sci-fi movie, but it is real. Well, it will be. DNA cryptography works largely like classic cryptography with a private and public key. But because it is incredibly fast, the keys can be massive, like that big. Yeah. DNA computing has the promise of cheap, huge, accessible data storage and an exponential increase in computing power and speed. There are huge challenges still, though, not least the cost of creating the DNA. But we are past the proof of concept phase and real money is being spent to create real commercial solutions. Do you have an opinion on DNA computing and what it could be used for? Start the conversation in the forum for the show. Link is in the description. And you can, of course, find me on Twitter. I'm at LastClint, or through the A-Cloud Guru Facebook page and other social media channels. This has been The Future of Tech, a show continuously made from a single strand of Viking DNA. Which is funny because I'm Danish, so it's Viking and it's Viking DNA, and that makes it funny. Okay, I'm going now. Bye.